no pseudoscience please any heading. It's a piece from the Hindu today, and it's authored by Hamid Dabholkar. Basically what he is saying is that one should not believe in pseudosciences. Many pseudosciences are there today. The main thing he's talking about is astrology. Okay, then now ours is a country which has sent say a spacecraft to Mars, Mangalyaan, etc. We have done, and we have gone to Antarctica and hoisted a flag there, etc. Such a country, should a large number of people in such a country believe in astrology, is, you know, the question he is asking. And it also says that recently the whole thing begins with the fact that the Indira Gandhi National Open University recently introduced a degree course in astrology. Now, how can you start a degree course in a subject which is not a science, is what he is asking. It's neither an art nor a science. It's just a, according to him, I mean, I don't necessarily, incidentally, today's, my take is rather neutral, you must remember that. But he is saying that how can you introduce a course like that in a national university funded by the government of India, etc. And he also says, reminds us that 2001, 20 years ago, the Atal Bihari Vajpayee government also had done such a thing, but then they withdrew it following widespread opposition. Then the syllabus now introduced also includes horoscopes. No, he says that it is unscientific and potentially dangerous to allow something like astrology as a mainstream course. Why? He says we all need to take a stance about this. Why? He says because in an era where pseudoscience has started becoming the new normal, it's our responsibility as citizens to oppose such decisions and withdraw the demand the withdrawal of such courses, he says. Now, then he proceeds to explain why. But before we go into this, I would like to tell you all that Jyotisha is one of the four Vedangas. Okay, one of the four parts of the one of the Vedangas, and it does not profess to teach astronomy, but it conveys knowledge of heavenly bodies, which is required according to the Vedic belief to fix auspicious times for doing things and for marriages and you know and for rituals, etc. Now, these horoscopes are determined that by the state of different planets at the time of a person's birth, and which they believe in the Hindu Vedic way of life is that the planets influence the manner in which your future unfolds. Now, my simple point is this. Religion is largely faith. I think long ago in a class, I discussed this in with the classes from Tirupati and Rajahmundry, that when you have faith in something, you should not get logic into it. Because logic is different and faith is different. Faith is something, by definition, it is taken as given. So, like one question we discussed some time ago, can God make a stone so big that he cannot move it himself? If he can make it, he cannot move it. If he cannot move it, he cannot make it. That means either way, it is a dilemma. It is what is called a fallacy, mathematical fallacy, logical fallacy rather. So, faith, we should not look for logic when you believe in faith. Then, many cultures from ancient times, the Hindus, the Chinese, the Maya developed, the people, even in Christianity, and all these people have, believed in prophecy and in astrology. Therefore, throughout history, in fact, astrology was treated as a scholarly tradition. They were regarded as well-read and intellectual people. And in fact, from Dante and Chaucer in the olden days up to Shakespeare, you'll find astrology being mentioned in the works. So now the author's objection is that there are three basic assumptions in the astrology. First, that planets affect human life. Second, that the result depends on the time of birth. And the third, the future depends on your time of birth and it can be changed through rituals, etc. So the main objections of those who profess to be scientists and believe in astronomy are that firstly, we say Navagrahalu and include sun in them. According to astronomy, the sun is not a planet at all, it's a star. And Rahu and Ketu are not even planets, they're just intersection points of the orbits of the sun and the moon. And the moon is only a satellite of the earth, it's not even a Navagraha. But that way, my simple point is, it's a question of definition, no? Whether you call something a planet, a star, or a satellite, that is not the point. They called it Graham. But the point is, those nine are taken as the ones that influence human life. Right or wrong is a separate issue. It's a question of definition only. Then, the author raises many questions. He says, actually, according to modern science, a baby is born the minute the sperm and the ovum come together. And then 9 months later, the birth takes place. So 9 months ago, the baby was born according to him. I have no quarrel with that. But the astrology is only saying that I will regard the time of birth as the time, important point at which the planetary movement should be noticed. It's a question of definition. Whether you call that birth or this birth is not a question. I'm calling this event as the event at which I'll look at the planetary positions. That's the time. You cannot have any objection to that. The science is a different thing altogether. So, and then astrology doesn't say not from the moment of your getting life, the moment of your birth, getting out of the mother's womb is the point of importance. So, and again, the author said thousands of children are born at the same time, but they have different futures. How come? For that, astrology has a simple explanation. We just now said, no, that events can be changed through rituals and yagas and yajnas and various practices, etc. So obviously different people have different futures. That will be the astrologer's defense. Then, now the author further points out that the man called Elon Musk has actually started a project called SpaceX mission to humanize Mars, to put up a colony in Mars and all that. And Stephen Hawking has encouraged a program called SETI, that is Search for Extraterritorial Intelligence, which is looking for life forms in the in outer space apart from the Earth. So the author feels that astrology explores the vulnerability of the human mind, while astrophysics is science based on principles, like we discussed the other day, experiment, observation, inference, etc. Now, many things are there in astrology, according to him, which are beliefs and practices which claim to be scientific and factual, but incompatible with the scientific method, because contradictory, exaggerated, and unfalsifiable claims. You see, one cardinal principle of science and mathematics, you must all remember this, very important, is what is called falsifiability. If I make a statement, theoretically, it should be possible to prove that it is wrong. So, just like they should not be like the can God move a stone kind of thing. You can neither prove it nor disprove it. So, that falsifiability is not there in astrology, according to him. So, he says, not understanding the difference between science and pseudoscience can lead to philosophical, political, scientific problems which have to be guarded against. And also, suppose, according to him, I believe in homeopathy, I use it, but the author says, if you believe in things like homeopathy, which according to him are not scientific, then healthcare and can get affected and human quality of life can suffer. Similarly, expert testimony. Now, suppose you put a person in the witness box and he's a doctor. And if he's a qualified being within quotation marks, an allopathic doctor, he will answer questions according to scientific principles, but not those who practice Ayurveda or homeopathy or Yunani or something like that. So he says that such superstitious beliefs can even influence countries' policies and education, which is deleterious to public welfare. So, and he also says that sometimes they have led to even racial and ethnic problems, which is true in history, it has happened. Because, wars have been waged because one religion believes that, like for instance, it is not true. Islam doesn't preach intolerance, nor does it say, you must use violence against anyone, including those who don't believe in Islam. But fundamentalists, like there are such people in Hinduism also, as you know, intolerance is happening in some parts of our country about beef eating and things like that. So fundamentalists believe, you know, that kafirs, those who don't believe in Islam, so that's why wars have taken place in the world also. So superstition and unscientific beliefs can lead to even conflict and strife is what the author says. Then, but on the other hand, let us see. There are many practices in like pseudoscience, like astrology is one. Alchemy, that means the art of finding gold through chemistry, which is not scientific, at all, I agree. And then alternative medicine, we discussed Yunani, Ayurveda, and homeopathy, etc. And occult sciences, making sacrifices and talking to ghosts and things like that. So all these are not, according to him, scientific methods. But on the other hand, please remember, Galileo, Newton, and Copernicus, you must be knowing, they disproved the church. The church believed that the center was the earth was the center of the universe. But Galileo changed all that. So did Newton and Copernicus, the planets, movements, and then gravitation, etc. The whole thing completely changed the way you looked at the universe. But Einstein proved Newton to be wrong. And then Einstein himself made a mistake. He thought the universe was static, so he could not balance one equation, so introduced a constant called lambda, what is called the cosmological constant. Then he himself gave it up saying, I made a terrible blunder. But today, that blunder is the thing which is explaining most of the secrets of the universe. So science itself is clearly not infallible and varies over time. And therefore, one has to be guarded in making harsh and hasty conclusions about in this discussion. And you all know that Varahamihira, the famous astronomer of ancient times, calculated the speed of light precisely to the same number as science has shown it to be today. What is called the Michelson-Morley experiment, they calculated the speed of light, those two, using mirrors and all that. But then that was known long, long ago. Similarly, 1200 years before Newton, Bhaskaracharya, the mathematician, knew about gravitation. So one should not poo-poo the Vedic knowledge and ancient work carelessly. Now, finally, he says there's such a furor about Smriti Irani going to a astrologer recently. So he says, do you all know that the most rationalist kind of person we ever had as Prime Minister, Jawaharlal Nehru, who really had, was not exactly an atheist, but an agnostic, definitely. He also went to an astrologer. There's a photograph also in the item which I looked up today. So, ultimately, it's difficult to take a stance in this matter. Now, for instance, I know an MLA called Mohan Reddy, was also a minister subsequently. When I was in Kurnool once, I had gone to the hospital for some treatment of a wound. He saw me. He said, you're Mr. Mohan Kanda, isn't it? I said, yes. Then he said, you're going to have a son soon. And it happened. Now, he didn't look at my hand. He didn't ask my date of birth. So there is something called a prescience also in this. Some people, like I had a Guruji once called Ganapati Shastri in Samalkota near Kakinada, who used to just look at a person and then predict events, most of which came true. So there can be some sort of supernatural, meta-scientific or outside science, kind of extra scientific kind of happenings and understandings of things in the universe, which one cannot understand. But one thing on the other whole, we are in the 21st century, and things which are not generally accepted to be scientific are, for instance, if homeopathy and Yunani are pseudoscience, why do you have a government in India department for them and have a whole, and you know, an entire lot of officers working for the government for them, and they are taught officially, their diplomas are given, etc., and in the universities of our country. So it is not as if, you know, you can take a firm and rigid stand in these matters. It's a question ultimately of your personal belief. But one thing is certain, you should be tolerant of people who believe in things which you don't, on the one hand. On the other hand, by and large, those things which society regards as outdated or primitive, perhaps society officially should not encourage them or fund them and things like that. Although the fundamental right of believing in what you want can always be has to be conceded. So I take on this thing today, and there's also an event recently. The Tamil Nadu Chief Minister Palaniswamy, he laid the foundation stone for the construction of a memorial for Jayalalitha, the former Chief Minister. Now, whether Jayalalitha deserves a memorial or a separate issue, but then a formal Shankusthapana, as they call it, the stone laying ceremony where Brahmins came, chanted Vedic verses, etc. And promptly the DMK leaders complained, saying that how can you spend government money on a non-secular event like Vedas being, Hindu Vedas being, which I think I agree, which there I draw a line, whether it is Christianity, Islam or the Hinduism, the government, secular government must stay at arm's length. That does not mean you must practice all religions, not at all. Like, you know, giving subsidies to people who are going for Hajj and going to your Mansarovar, and also for to pilgrimage to Israel, so to be treated as to be to give the appearance of being secular. No, I think you should stay away from all religions. That is the meaning of secularity. This is my take. I'll be happy to take any questions or doubts that you have.